Hi everyone and welcome to another video. Today, we will take a deep dive into this Dell Optiplex 5070 SFF. In the video, I'll start with a quick overview and then disassemble the machine completely, followed by a reassembly and upgrading the memory. Once the machine is back together and hopefully still works fine of course, I'll also install Windows 11 and do some performance benchmarks so we have a rough idea how fast this device is. The Dell Optiplex 5070 is about 5 years old now, as it was released in June 2019. It's based on the Intel Q370 chipset, and it is considered as the successor of the Optiplex 5060, which I have here with me as well. Originally, I wanted to do a separate video on this 5060, but hardware-wise, these are so identical that it would not make any sense. The main difference is that the 5060 came only with 8th generation Intel Core CPUs, while this 5070 supports both the 8th and 9th generation of the same CPUs. I got these two devices for around 80 euro per piece, which I honestly find a pretty good deal. Seeing the main target audience of these Optiplex SFF machines and considering the age, I'm pretty sure these are office PCs which were written off the books and got replaced by something newer. Design-wise, these machines look pretty good to my opinion. Just sober, business-like, but robust with a vibe of quality. As you can see, the case has rubber feet on two sides. So, you can use the machine vertically, like it would be a small tower, or horizontally, like a classic desktop. At the front of the machine, we can find a USB 3.1 Gen 1 port, a USB 3.1 Gen 2 Type-C port, two USB 2.0 ports, where the bottom one, as is the case for the USB-C port as well, allows you to charge up devices, better known as PowerShare. Here we also have an audio jack, a slot for an optional card reader, hard drive activity LED, and a power button with an integrated power LED. On top, we can also see a slot for an optical drive, which is not present in my case. At the back of the machine, we can find another audio jack, two DisplayPort ports, four USB 3.1 Gen 1 ports, two times USB 2.0, and Ethernet. And finally, here we have the power supply with its power connector. Let's take a look inside now. By sliding this blue latch here to the right, we can remove the top cover easily. Inside, you can see that the case is actually pretty empty. We can see the CPU fan, a 200 watt power supply, an empty drive cage with the NVMe M2 SSD under there, and we can also slightly see the single DDR4 memory module that's already installed. Let's start our disassembly now by getting that drive cage out of here. After removing the cables that are guided through the latch, we can unlock the cage. But before we can get it out, we still need to remove the front panel first. That can easily be done by unclipping it like this. There we go. In the drive cage, there is place for a 3.5-inch drive and also an optical drive. But I'm pretty sure that you can use this bottom space for a 2.5-inch SATA drive as well. With the drive cage out, we get a better look at the NVMe SSD and the memory slots. In here, a single 8GB module is currently installed, but during our reassembly, we'll add another one to increase that to 16GB and be able to use dual channel. Next, let me get the SATA cables out. These are actually not used for this machine's configuration, but it's pretty convenient that these are here already, so we have them in case you would like to add an additional drive. Power for these SATA drives is provided through the motherboard with this 6-pin proprietary cable. After disconnecting the CPU fan, we can also disconnect the power supply, which is only connected with this 4-pin connector and this 6-pin connector. Close by, we also have a tiny built-in speaker. And on the other side, we can disconnect the power button and LED as well. All cables are disconnected now, so let's remove the CPU fan next. It's directly fixed with 3 screws onto the heatsink. This assembly looks completely custom to me, so I'm not sure how easy it would be to replace the fan inside in case that would be required. Now that that fan is gone, we can also unscrew the heatsink from the case. And then get it out. Well, this machine can be very old, yet the thermal paste looks pretty crunchy already, and I'm sure that the CPU will be very happy to get this refreshed. Speaking of that CPU, after we got it cleaned up, we can open up the socket and get that one out as well. Not sure how visible it is on the video, but we do have an Intel Core i5-9500 installed. The i5-9500 is a 9th generation Intel Core i5 processor, and it's equipped with 6 cores, has a base frequency of 3 GHz, but can boost up to a massive 4.4 GHz, and together with the 9 MB of smart cache, this should perform pretty well to my ID. I'm actually curious to see the results on the CPU benchmark later. Let's see now if we can get the motherboard out of the case. I'll start by removing the 5 regular screws that hold the board there. Then we also need to remove this taller screw that locks the drive cage and this metal bracket on the front. Finally, we also need to get the NVMe SSD out. As you can see, this is a really small version from SK Hynix. On the back, it's equipped with a thermal pad to conduct heat away. The screw that holds that M2 drive in place is the last screw that fixes the motherboard to the case, so once we got that one out, we should be able to remove the board. As you can see, it's a tight fit, so it may take a bit of practice and patience, but as long as you stay calm, it eventually gets out. Before inspecting the motherboard, let's take a look at the power supply first. As you can see, it can deliver up to 200 watts as I mentioned already. That means that since the CPU has a TDP of 65 watts, and of course you need a bit of power for the motherboard, memory and NVMe drive as well, it leaves a reasonable power budget for a dedicated GPU. Unfortunately, the options for that are pretty limited, as you will need to go for a low profile version if you want it to fit in the case. In theory, the fastest option could be an NVIDIA RTX 4060, but that uses already around 110 to 120 watts, and I think it might be too close to the limits. Something like an AMD RX 6400 would probably be a safer choice here. But back to our machine now. And as promised, let's take a good look at the motherboard. Over here, we have the CPU socket, 1, 2, 3, 4 DDR4 DIMM slots, 1, 2, 3 SATA ports, M2 slot for SATA or NVMe SSD, slot for an M2 Wi-Fi card, open-ended PCIe X4 slot and a regular PCIe X16, a connector for an additional USB-C port, video connector, serial port header, intrusion detection, connectors for the power button and speaker, CMOS battery, header for the front panel card reader, 6-pin power input and 4-pin power input, power output for SATA drives and a CPU fan connector. Before we start putting things back together, let's take a look at all the components we have. We have the motherboard, CPU, SSD, original 8 GB of memory and that additional 8 GB DIMM, SATA cables and the CPU heatsink and fan. The reassembly starts by putting that motherboard back in the case. Again, it takes a bit of wiggling and patience before it fits. Once it is in, let's get it fixed back to the case. Including that front bracket. And also that screw that holds the M2 storage device where it belongs. And while we are here, let's put back that NVMe SSD as well. We just need to slide it in the slot and fix it to that screw. The CPU goes back to where it belongs. Just open the slot, make sure that the CPU is positioned correctly, and then close it. A healthy amount of fresh thermal paste goes on the CPU, and then we can also reinstall the heatsink and fix that to the case through the motherboard. On top of that goes the fan assembly, which we can fix as well. And of course, we shouldn't forget to connect the fan to the header on the motherboard. Next, I'll get the memory installed. As mentioned, we have 4 slots on the motherboard, and these represent two channels. The correct order to install DIMMs is as follows. First, the white slots, DIMM 1 and DIMM 2, then DIMM 3 and DIMM 4. So, as we have two modules, we'll populate these in the two white slots. That way, we should have dual channel support, which should result in better performance. Let's connect the rest of the cables now. First, the internal speaker, then the power button and LED, and the two power input cables. Finally, we can also install the power cable for SATA drives and the SATA cables, which are just there for future use. As last, we can reinstall the drive cage. Lock it and put the SATA cables nicely through the cable guide. All done here, so let's put back the front panel, followed by the top cover. I got everything connected, so let's see if the disassembly and reassembly was a success. The system seems to boot, but shows us a warning message about the change in memory size, which makes sense as we just upgraded it. Let me click continue and check fast what is currently on the SSD before we take a look at the BIOS and perform a fresh installation of Windows 11. Looks like a clean install of Windows 10 is on here, but we'll get rid of that. After restarting the machine, I'm pressing F12 repeatedly, as that will bring us to the boot menu. In the boot menu, let's open the BIOS setup. In system information, we can see that we now have 16 GB of memory, and it is operating in dual channel mode as we want it. We can also see that we have the NVMe drive detected in the M2 slot, and of course the i5-9500 CPU is listed here as well. For the rest, the BIOS setup has plenty of options. This is typical for these kinds of machines from Dell, and I can always appreciate that. Let's insert the USB drive with the Windows 11 installer, exit the BIOS setup, and then press F12 again to bring up the boot menu. This time, I will choose for the USB drive to boot the system. In the Windows 11 installer, we can just continue. Then delete all existing partitions from the SSD and select all of the unallocated space and perform the actual installation. And after a bit of patience, we get to the initial setup dialog, also known as the out-of-box experience. Let's quickly run a command that allows us to avoid the need for a network connection, and then we can run through all the steps. And after a bit more patience, we end up with our freshly installed Windows 11 on this machine. Before doing some benchmarks, I will of course first make sure that all Windows updates are installed. And once that is done, after another set of patience, let's take a look at About This PC. In here, we can find that the same hardware is shown as we could see in the BIOS setup. The same goes for Task Manager, of course. Time for some benchmarks now, and let's test that CPU by running Geekbench 5 first. The results look pretty good. 1136 for single core and 5299 for multi-core. If we compare these results with some machines that I tested earlier, we can see that the performance is as expected. Slightly faster than an i5-9400, slightly slower than an i5-9600. Let us repeat the test now with the newer version Geekbench 6. we're getting similar numbers here, 1590 for single core and 5740 for multi-core. Again, we see this is between an i7-8700T and its regular version, the i7-8700. Surprisingly, it's a lot faster than an earlier system that I tested with the 10th generation i5 here. Most likely something went wrong there because these numbers are really low, but even if I compare this with the average results for that newer CPU, our 9th generation i5-9500 performs pretty good. Let's test the performance of that NVMe SSD now. I will do so with Crystal Dismark. Sequential write, with a good queue depth, gets us near 2 GB per second, and with a smaller queue depth, still close to 1 GB per second. Random reading isn't too bad either, and in line with the expectations. Write performance is a bit lower, but that's kind of expected with this type of SSD. We get 842 and 766 MB per second for the sequential test, and pretty impressive numbers for the random write test as well. All in all, I must say that these results are definitely above my expectations. I have been testing a lot of SFF machines for around the same budget over the last years, and these type of PCs have become so cheap on the used market that for most use cases, except maybe gaming or where you really need top performance, this is the way to go. The price difference with a new machine versus the difference in performance is just very big, so these are definitely to consider. That was all I had for the video. Hopefully it helped you to get to know this lovely compact PC a bit better. Thanks a lot for watching. I hope you have liked this video, and if you did, I would appreciate a thumbs up. Let me know if you have any questions in the comments, and make sure to subscribe and enable notifications if you like these kind of videos. Thanks again, and hope to see you back here soon.